Gurdjieff was a vigorous, charismatic man with a robust sexual nature, described by biographer James Webb as a sensual man who enjoyed the pleasures of the bed as much as those of the table. Gurdjieff's sexual conduct shocked many people in the 1920s and 1930s, especially in conservative America. There were rumors that he had a highly varied sex life and was involved in unusual sexual activities. Some claimed he was a master of exotic tantric sexual practices learned in the East. He clearly possessed a sophisticated and nuanced understanding of the role of sexuality in the process of spiritual transformation, and enunciated a complex model of the transmutation of sexual energy to a higher developmental level. Gurdjieff's personal sex life appears from all accounts to have been complex and sometimes contradictory, with varied expressions throughout his life. At times he was celibate, at other periods highly sexually charged. He fathered numerous children out of wedlock, including many with his own female disciples. Gurdjieff was of the opinion that sexual energy in the modern Western world was misused in the pursuit of personal pleasure and gratification. He claimed that, in general, the only two proper ways of expending sexual energy were through a conventional sex life or through spiritual transmutation. Right work on oneself, Gurdjieff taught, begins with the creation of a permanent center of gravity, a task which is supported by the correct use of sexual energy. The role of the sex center in creating a general equilibrium and a permanent center of gravity can be very big. According to its energy, that is to say, if it uses its own energy, the sex center stands on a level with the higher emotional center. And all the other centers are subordinate to it. Therefore, it would be a great thing if it worked with its own energy. This alone would indicate a comparatively very high level of being. And in this case, that is, if the sex center worked with its own energy and in its own place, all other centers would work correctly in their places and with their own energies. Gurdjieff also insisted that achieving an orgasm before reaching adulthood had serious consequences on an adolescent's mental development, if even once the sensation of the climax of what is called the Oumanvinassinian process occurs in what is called the nervous system of their children before they reach majority, they will already never have the full possibility of normal mentation when they become adults. His sexual life was strange in its unpredictability. At certain times he led a strict, almost ascetic life, having no relation with women at all. At other times, his sex life seemed to go wild, and it must be said that his unbridled periods were more frequent than the ascetic. At times, he had sexual relationships not only with almost any woman who happened to come within the sphere of his influence, but also with his own pupils. Quite a number of his women pupils bore him children, and some of them remained closely connected with him all their lives. Others were just as close to him, as far as one could tell without a sexual relationship. Almost everyone who met Gurdjieff was struck by his powerful personality and commanding presence. Together his physical attributes, personal magnetism, and immense knowledge created an impression of great strength and mastery. Gurdjieff possessed an enigmatic quality and a mystique that set him apart from other men. The widely held belief that he possessed hypnotic and psychic powers only deepened his aura of mystery. His alleged use of these abilities as part of his teaching, condemned in some traditional spiritual circles, has always been a source of controversy. Gurdjieff possessed an undeniable personal power and magnetism. The sheer force of his presence made a lasting impact on others. Student Henriette Lons describes the impression Gurdjieff made at their first meeting. "I was struck by the impact of his force, very quiet, calm and controlled, yet almost frightening, but more than anything by the degree of his total presence, a presence which I felt extended to the tips of his fingers. It gave meaning to all his movements, which seemed so much more alive than ours. As alive as those of a cat or a tiger. I also felt very strongly his vast generosity, a generosity which I would call superhuman." Gurdjieff's physical qualities contributed to his impact on others. Although of only average height, he appeared physically powerful with a broad and sturdy build. When he moved, he did so with extraordinary coordination, which students have described as feline in nature. Alspensky noticed the remarkable assurance and precision in all of Gurdjieff's movements, and Zuber observed that his gait and his gestures were never hurried, but followed in unison with the rhythm of his breathing like those of a peasant or a mountaineer. Even in his later years, Gurdjieff maintained an impressive physique. Students who saw him in the baths noted that his muscle tone remained firm despite the additional weight he carried. Perhaps the most compelling physical feature of Gurdjieff was the power of his eyes. Students have described them as piercing and of unusual depth and penetration. John Bennett said that Gurdjieff had the strangest eyes that he had ever seen, with each being very different in expression from the other. Gurdjieff's undeniable force of character acted as a magnet in attracting students, many of whom were soon in awe of their teacher's extraordinary power. René Zuber was among them. He seemed to be filled with an experience, almost incommunicable, which set him at an unbearable distance from the common run of mortals.